I'm here in Jersey City, experiencing the aftermath of Hurricane Sandy firsthand. A lot of power grids are still not working, and buildings are running off of generators. Buildings like the Jersey City Armory, which right now houses over 150 people, keeping them warm and safe. Yet more are expected throughout the night.
You gotta sign now. You gotta sign now. Coming in just for the
homes here in New Jersey suffered extensive damage in the storm. And whether it's a bed, food, or medical care these people need, the volunteers here are willing to help.
Going strong.
Most of these people don't have any homes, so they need really shelter. You know, they don't have any food. You know, we've got clothing available, so really most of these people need shelter, somewhere to, you know, a hot meal, somewhere to sleep. Everyone volunteered. Everyone just wanted to come and help whatever way they can.
Since recovery efforts started less than a week ago, service members have worked alongside the Red Cross and AmeriCorps to provide for those that need it most right now. People like Josette Williamson, a mother of three whose house was flooded just this week.
They have been wonderful. They've helped me with milk, diapers. My children are able to eat. I have an 8-year-old there, so of course he needs more than milk. He's able to eat. He's able to, have fun, interact, despite, what's going on around him. Everyone is awesome. That's it. I really appreciate all the help.
Power issues are being resolved as fast as they can throughout the city, and the number of people here at the Jersey City Armory has decreased daily.
This Air Force is real cool.
Reporting for the Air Force Broadcasting Service.
They are very good people.
I'm Staff Sergeant Chris Piles.
Well, look.
There are a few who move toward the sounds of chaos. Ready to respond at a moment's notice. And when the time comes, they are the first to move toward the sounds of tyranny, injustice, and despair. They are forged in the crucible of training. They are the few, the proud, the Marines.
So weary, when troubles come and my heart burden be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. Raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up so walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can. There is no life without its hunger. Each restless heart beats so imperfectly.
Marines! Marines, gasoline, not lose. The fate of the world rests in one top secret mission.
This is my last election, for you.
Yeah.
After my election, I have more flexibility.
And this, I transmit this information to Vladimir and Ms. Denver.
Your mission is simple, Mr. Obama. Win one last election to gain unchecked flexibility, weaken our defenses, and fundamentally transform the world. Dmitry will transmit the information.
I transmit this information to Vladimir and Ms. Denver.
Starring Barack Obama as President Flexible, Dmitry Medvedev as Dr. Transmitkov, and Vladimir Putin as himself.
After my election, I am more flexible. After my election, I am more flexible.
Operation Hot Mic.
Scream and fly away all your fears. dust off the robes you're wearing. Set aside the names that you've been given. May this place a rest in the fold of your journey. Find you tall. You will never walk alone.
In the shelter of each other, we will live, we will
never
live.
Never walk alone.
In the shelter of each other, we will live, we will
live. We know the rocks will cry out, and the tears aren't ours alone. Let them fall into the hands that hold us. Come away from where you're hiding. Set aside the lies that you've been living. And may this place a rest. Fold of your journey, bind you tall. We will never walk alone.
In the shelter of each other, we will live, we will live.
In the shelter.
What you pray, I pray. Jesus only did what he saw you do. He would only say what he heard you speak. He would only move when he felt you lead, following your heart, following your spirit. How could I expect to walk without you?
Soon forget.
Will you pray, I pray? Will you pray, I pray? We go, I go, what you say, I say. What you pray, I pray.
I am an American soldier.
I'm a warrior and a member of a team.
I serve the people of the United States and live the Army values.
I will always place this first.
I will never accept defeat.
I will never accept defeat.
I will never quit.
I will never leave a fallen comrade.
I am disciplined.
I am disciplined.
Physically and mentally tough.
Trained and proficient in my warrior tasks and drills.
I'm an expert, and I'm a professional.
I stand ready to deploy, engage, and destroy the
enemies of the United States of America in close combat.
I am a guardian of freedom and the American way of life.
I am an American soldier.
I am an American soldier.
I am an American soldier.
They're strong, and there's Army Strong. See what it takes at GoArmy.com.
Hi, I'm Katie Yoder with MRC TV. Today, the group Acts 529 is at the White House protesting the HHS mandate and supporting religious freedom. They have a... You're here today protesting the HHS mandate, correct? That's the main reason you're here?
Yes, the whole Acts 5:29, of course, is taken after the Bible verse, Acts 5:29, which says we must obey God rather than man. The HHS mandate ends up putting the church in a situation where we're going to have to choose between following our convictions or following the laws of our country.
It's forcing people to pay for abortions.
We're affirming religious freedom. We're affirming the basic fundamental values that all Americans cherish and hold dear.
The only hope we have right now to end this mandate is to change out the president.
The whole reason for this, you know, outgoing protest and this outgoing arrest is to show the president, I mean, the type of relationship that he is setting up with the church.
And then to send a powerful statement to President Obama, we are willing to risk arrest in front of the White House to tell him we will not comply with an unjust mandate.
This is definitely going to be something remembered in history. The time when a president brought up a bill that was to violate our conscience, and we stood up, and this is the beginning.
So as you can see, we've been forced outside the secure perimeter. Behind me, you can see that the protesters have been pretty much gated off from anyone else, so it's basically them and the police. They've got another area here for the police. They're letting a few press on the other side of the gate, but if you're a commoner, then you're out here watching from the distance.
Acts 5:29. Yeah. Yeah, really. They've just been third day or so they've done that.
Yeah, and they
Viva Cristo Rey!
So mightily and so greatly, Lord,
yes, Lord,
that nobody could deny your presence, nobody could deny your grace, Lord, and that we would just see a change. Lord, I thank you for the men and women who are in this car with me right now, Lord, who are handcuffed, who are tired, who are hot, Lord. I just ask that you would be with us in this time and that you would comfort us so greatly, Lord, that we would just see your grace through all of this and that our words and our actions would not be unheard, Lord, that everyone would see that even if it isn't 10 years along the line, somebody would look at us and say, wow, they fought for me. And at the time, I didn't even care. I thought they were stupid. But now I see the things that they've done.
Yes, Lord.
So, Lord, I just ask that our words here today, and in the past few days, and even tomorrow, Lord, would not be worth nothing, that they would be worth something great, that they would be awesome, they would just be powerful, that, Lord, you would empower our thoughts, you would empower our minds, you would empower the things that we have done here this weekend, Lord. Your grace is above all grace. Your love is above all love. So, Lord, I just ask that you would spread that out, that you would see that we are not here to take away the rights of women, but give rights to those who are not given any at all. Lord, I just ask that you would be with our fellow sisters today, Lord, who are seeking out an abortion, who are seeking out either a life of comfort, Lord, or they just feel like that's their only option, Lord. I ask that you provide them options today, Lord, that today would just be a day where no child dies.
Yes.
And then that would just continue, Lord. That would just be a constant thing, that every day would suddenly become a day where no child dies.
Jesus Christ.
Lord, I just ask, once again, Lord, just be with the women who cannot hear you, who do not know your voice. Lord, I ask that you would speak to them now.
On 9, and this is an incredible story. It starts with some tense moments for a young pregnant mother on her way to the hospital as she ends up giving birth inside her car.
It all turned into a complicated situation with a roller coaster ride of emotions.
News 9's Michael Konopolsky joins us with this story. Michael?
Well, Kelly and Amanda, Keaton Mason and her fiancé were just 15 minutes away from home when their baby decided it was time. What happened next is being called a miracle, a gift from God.
It was crazy. It made me cry.
It was just before 10 Thursday evening. People at this truck stop were in for a surprise.
The lady was screaming, my baby's blue, she's not breathing.
A baby girl born in the passenger seat of this Honda had the umbilical cord wrapped around her neck. Mom and dad were on the phone with 911, panicking, not knowing what to do. In that moment, the baby was not breathing, but help was just feet away.
Her angel was there.
He was our angel that night, that's for sure.
A man named Gary Wilson was in the right place at the right time.
He did everything perfectly right.
Gary saved the infant's life by freeing her neck, tying the umbilical cord, and rubbing her back.
Looked over and this guy's holding a sign saying Memphis.
The hero, a homeless man hitchhiking east.
I would describe him as kind of like looking at Jesus. He had the long hair, the long beard. Very nice gentleman.
He kept me pretty calm, actually. He kept telling me, you know, everything's okay, she's breathing.
On one of the 911 calls,
6 inches from the baby, do not cut it,
is a polite, calm voice.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay,
I'll do that. Now, 6 inches away from the baby.
The voice of Gary Wilson, who by the next morning was already long gone. Well, Tatum Brown was born 4 pounds, 11 ounces, and 4 weeks early, but doctors say she is doing just fine.
Catholic leaders are up in arms. Now bishops are fired up over the new Obamacare-related rules.
What I want to know is, where are the women?
I could for one say that's not a war on women.
They think women care more about free birth control than about freedom of religion.
I refuse to choose something that violates my conscience and my rights as an American.
If everybody in America doesn't have religious liberty, nobody in America has religious liberty.
She put forward the narrative, the normalization of uncommitted sex as a good for women. Boy, she does not speak for all women.
The exemption said the only thing that counts as religious is what happens within the four walls of a church. This isn't the definition of religion.
I would ask unanimous consent to put into the record an open letter to the president that is being signed by women all over this country.
Government contraceptive programs inevitably change the sex, dating, and marriage markets in ways that lead to more empty sex. And I'm pretty sure they meant that in a negative way.
Honey, they don't drop the bombs unless they're over the target. Whatever it is that you're putting out there on this makes them really mad. So just keep doing it.
Identifying enemy sniper.
Copy that. Let's move. Thanks, Reaper 1-1. We got it from here. Sensors coming off target.
Learn more at airforce.com.
The call to serve. It has no sound. Yet I have heard it in the whispered retelling of honorable sacrifices made by those who have served before me. The call to serve has no form, yet I have clearly seen it in the eyes of men and women infinitely more courageous and more driven than most. The call to serve has no weight, yet I have held it in my hands. I will commit to carry it close to my heart until my country is safe and the anguish of those less fortunate has been soothed. The call to serve is at once invisible and always present. And for those who choose to answer the call, for their country, for their fellow man, for themselves, it is the most powerful force on earth. America's Navy, a global force.
God, we look to you tonight. Above the singing, God, above the music, above the songs, let your name be lifted high, Jesus. Let your name be honored, God. And we commit all that we are to you, God, and everything that we do. And we reach towards you, Jesus.
Speak to me now.
sea of forgetfulness. The chains of yesterday surround me. I yearn for peace and rest. I don't want to end up where you found me. And it echoes in my mind, keeps me awake tonight. I know you've cast my sin as far as the east is from the west. And I stand before you now as though I've never sinned. But today I feel like I'm just one mistake away from you leaving me this way. Jesus, can you show me just how far the east is from the west? 'Cause I can't bear to see the man I've been rising up in me again. In the arms of your mercy I find rest. 'Cause you know just how far the east is from the west, from one scarred hand to the other. Reminding of my sin, and time again, your truth is drowned out by the storm I'm in. Today I feel like I'm just one mistake away from you leaving me this way. Jesus, can you show me just how far the east is from the west? 'Cause I can't bear to see from rising up in me again. In the arms of your mercy I find rest. 'Cause you know just how far the east is from the west, one scarred hand to the other. I know you've washed me white, turned my darkness into light. I need your peace to get me through, to get me through. Truth your word reveals, I'm not holding on to you, but you're holding on to me. You're holding on to me. Jesus, you know just how far the east is from the west. I don't have to see been rising up in me again. In the arms of your mercy I find rest. 'Cause you know just how far the east is from the west, one scarred hand to the other.
קדושת היום, כי הוא נורא ואיום, ובוא תנסה מלכות. מלכותך וכל בחסד כיסך ותשב עליו באמת ותשב עליו באמת
אמת כי אתה הוא דיין
ומוכיח ויודע ועד וסותב וחותם וסופר ומונה ותזכור כל הנשכחות ותפתח את ספר הזיכרונות ומאליו יקרא וחותם יד ושופר גדול יתקע וכל דממה דקה יישמע ומלאכים יחפזו וכיל רעדה משול כפרס הנשבר כחציר יבש וחצית נובר וחצר לובר ופעמן קלה וכרוח נושבת
to a life of courage.
and a commitment to something greater than themselves. They have always defended this nation and each other. They still do.
Number is 1-800-839-3002. And if you're watching on Ustream.tv, welcome to the Wiley Drake Ustream Television Network. Thank you for watching the Wiley Drake Show. We used to call it World Wide Web. Now it's the Worldwide Wiley Web. This is Tony. Good afternoon, Tony. God bless you. How are you? Yeah, we just went live. If you want to talk, probably be better to call in on the 800 number or the 559 number.
All right, thank you.
Bye-bye. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that's a friend of mine up in Virginia. Tony has a story that I've told many, many times. Of course, he has too, but basically, about 35 years ago, Tony got out one night, got drunk, ran off of a mountain, and broke his neck. Since that time, he's been in a wheelchair, but that doesn't stop him from serving the Lord Jesus Christ. He came to know the Lord as a result of breaking his neck. It's a shame that it took that. He would share with you that many times before he had been offered a relationship with Jesus and had turned it down. But when he realized that life was almost over for him and could be over for him, he made a deal with God. He said, God, if you'll let me live, I'll serve you. I'll accept you, I'll become a Christian, and I'll serve you. And that's exactly what happened. And that's exactly what he's done for the last 35 years. He can only move his arms enough to manipulate and roll the wheelchair. Good afternoon, Tony Wright. How are you, my friend?
I'm doing pretty good. How are you doing?
Well, we're doing just great. I just very briefly told a little bit about your story, the finished product of the Brewer's Ark, and how you were continuing now to serve the Lord Jesus even from a wheelchair. Tony, what's on your mind, my friend?
Well, I got a new book, and I have no idea what made me get it from the library except by the promise of God, but it was written this year, The Amateur, President Obama in the White House, and I'm over halfway through it. I just started a couple, 2 or 3 days ago, and he's trying to defend what he done for him. He tells about him, him saying he went around Israel and used them, and now he's trying to make up to them. And, he's backhanded, basically, now when he came over here a few days.
Yeah, now what's the name of the book?
Hold on just a minute, let me make sure.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, Tony's going to tell us about a book, and if Tony recommends a book, I very seriously consider that recommendation, because he is a man of God, and he wouldn't advise us to read something that's not good, that's not biblically based, and so he'll give us the name of that book here in a minute.
The Amateur, and underneath, Barack Obama in the White House. And I think we're getting ready from what I've heard to see 4 more years of that.
I'm afraid you're right. I hope you're not, but I'm noticing here, it says the amateur, I'm looking at something, it says the amateur on Amazon, and it's by Edward Klein, is that right?
Yeah.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm finding the amateur on Amazon, and you can get it on Kindle for about $9. If you buy the book on Amazon, in the next few days, you can get it for like $12. And so I would encourage you to get that book. I was looking to see if they would say anything about it, but let's see what it's called, The Amateur. And we're going to look at the table of contents here, maybe, The Amateur. Let's look at the table of contents. The table of contents says, hollow at the core, a ghostly presence. You keep out of this. You should know better. The man who prepared Obama for the presidency, drinking the Obama Kool-Aid. Bungler in chief, Clark Kent, Ground Zero, The Wrath of Michelle. James David Manning calls Obama the long-legged Mac Daddy, and he calls Michelle the fist bumper. Now, you'll have to call Dr. Manning and ask him about that one. I don't know about that one. And then chapter 12 is called Out to Lunch. And I would encourage you, ladies and gentlemen, on Tony's recommendation, I would encourage you to get the book. Looks like it has about 22 chapters. There's the new Obama, In Search of the Real Obama, The Rise of the Humanitarian, Mind Meld, The War on General Jones, and All in the Family, and a lot of other good stuff there, a lot of good chapters, looks like. And so I would encourage you to get the book, ladies and gentlemen. The book is by a man by the name of Edward Klein, New York Times best-selling author of The Truth About Hillary. And the book is entitled The Amateur, A Necessary Antidote to Obama Worship, says Denise Souza. Now, Barack Obama in the White House, I would recommend you get that book. And Brother Tony, how much have you read of it?
I've read a whole lot, just let me make sure.
Well, and
I'm on page 179.
Well, after you've read 178 pages, what do you think about the book? All right, well, brother, after you finish it, get back with us and give us another report. And let me ask you a question. Would you recommend people get the book?
I definitely would. I got it from a couple of libraries. I mean, but I'll read them quick. I read that's the second one I read
this week. Amen. Well, ladies and gentlemen, my brother in Christ, Tony Wright from Virginia, recommends this book, The Amateur. And I would say I have not read the book, had not heard of it, but do not know Edward Klein, but he's New York Times best-selling author of a book called The Truth About Hillary. And if it tells the truth about Hillary, it ought to be a good book. But the book that we're talking about is The Amateur. Brother Tony, thank you for that recommendation. And when you finish the book, I'll expect a full book report.
You sure will. God bless.
God bless you, Tony. Have a great day. Bye-bye.
I'll see you in the morning.
All right, bye. All right, ladies and gentlemen. Now, the reason Tony said, I'll talk to you in the morning, is another one of those projects that I'm involved in with people. And I'm going to give you a little rundown right now. Again, many of you watch this show, and many of you have been on the show with me. But I'm going to give you a little rundown about Wiley Drake and who he is and what he's involved in. This month, on the 23rd day of November, I will turn 69 years of age. I was born and raised in Arkansas. And in 1961, I put some shoes on and left the farm and went to beautiful, sunny Southern California, San Diego, California. Prior to the bus trip into San Diego, I had no idea. If you would have stopped me as a 17-year-old boy and said, "Where is San Diego, California?" I would have said, "I don't have the slightest idea," because I didn't. But I knew I was on the way to what my daddy called boot camp. Now, boot camp was what the Navy called basic training. And so I headed to San Diego for basic training, boot camp, at Naval Station San Diego Recruitment Training Center. And I spent my weeks there in basic training. And in that basic training, I not only learned how to be fit and learn how to fight, but I also learned that some of the teachings that I had received in Arkansas were absolutely wrong. You see, I'd been taught in Arkansas that we as white folks, I didn't know what a Caucasian was, but we as white people believed that we were better than any other people, whether they were red or yellow or black or brown. We felt like we were better. Now, I don't know why we thought that, because we weren't. In fact, I was a dumb country boy. Didn't have enough sense to come in out of the rain, but nevertheless, I thought I was better than anybody else. I knew better, but I'd been taught different. For you see, I grew up with two boys, one named Coy and one named Troy. They were twins. I think they were born in 1942 or 44. I'm not sure whether they were born just before me or just after me. But their aunt and uncle took care of them, and their aunt and uncle worked on the farm there in Arkansas for my grandfather and grandmother and for my mother and daddy. The man's name was Sonny Man. Now, I to this day do not know what his real name was or is. Don't think he's still alive. I think he's probably gone on home to be with the Lord. And his wife's name was Tot. And again, I had no idea what her real name was, but they were a couple that lived on the same little farm area that we lived on, outside of town. And they lived in a little shotgun shack. And they worked for my mom and dad and for my grandfather and grandmother. They were black folk, hard workers. And they had two nephews that were the same age I was. And those nephews would come and stay with Sonny Man and Todd. And as little boys, we would play together. And I loved those boys. And we had a great time together. But I was always told I was better than them. In fact, I told them I was better than them. And they didn't believe me, but they didn't fight about it. They just said, okay. And they were constantly proving that they were better runners and better workers and better everything than me. But they never taunted it over me or anything. But we grew up together, and I grew up being told that I was better than them. Then I went off to the Navy, and I met some other fellows from different parts of the country. And They were red and yellow and black and white. And I remembered a song my mother used to teach us in Vacation Bible School. Red and yellow, black and white, they're all precious in His sight. And so I began to question my teaching. And I began to realize that if we went to war, I'd have to depend upon not only my white friends, but my black friends and my Mexican friends and my Italian and other nationalities. And we were a team. We were a company in boot camp. We finished boot camp and went home for a little leave. And then after that leave, I went back to San Diego and they told me, here are your orders for your first duty assignment. And I received my first duty assignment. And as I've already shared on one of the other shows, I went to Naval Station Pearl Harbor, where I went into more training. And then later I went aboard the USS Kitty Hawk. In those days, it was called CVA 63. It's just called CV 63 now. Not sure why the Navy changed that, but at any rate, when I was on the Kitty, it was CVA 63. I was told that I was hand-picked and that I was a special member of a special crew, that there was a brand new special Navy ship coming out of the Camden, New Jersey shipyards, and that it was going to set sail in Camden and go down through the Atlantic Ocean and go down around the Horn, Cape Horn, and circle back up around and come into San Francisco Bay. Well, they did that, but not before they blew two or three boilers coming around the Horn because of the malfunction and the manufacturing in the shipyard. The ship limped in. There were four engine rooms, two boilers in each room, and you really needed to steam full speed. You needed both boilers and both engine rooms, but two or three of those boilers blew up and they couldn't use them, so they had to limp around the Horn, finally limped into San Francisco. And they pulled the USS Kitty Hawk into dry dock in San Francisco at Hunters Point. Now, before that, I had been stationed in Hawaii, and while I was stationed in Hawaii, I met my dear sweet wife, Barbara Julianne Stevens. And we continued to communicate by letter. Once in a while, we would get a phone call. No cell phones or texting in those days. And so I went to Hunters Point and went aboard the USS Kitty Hawk. And that's where I began my naval career, really, in its fullness. Later on, the Kitty Hawk was put back together. We put her back together. We repaired the boilers. We put everything back together, tightened down all the bolts, nuts, and screws, and set sail for Hawaii. And Hawaii had a special place in my heart because I had met a girl when I was there in Hawaii. And we set sail for Hawaii and the ship worked fine. And we headed back to San Diego, which was going to be our home port. And the Kitty Hawk pulled into San Diego. And while we were there, the captain came on one night and said, "Fellas, I'm here to inform you." This is the captain speaking. "And I'm here to inform you that we're getting ready to set sail, but I'm not at liberty to tell you where we're going or what we're going to be doing. That's top secret, cannot be revealed." And of course, we all knew that we were in a problem in the South China Sea. We had been fighting a war called the Indonesian War. And we suspected that that might be where we were going, and the captain would not confirm it or deny it. He just simply said, "Get your things in order. If you're married, kiss your wife an extra time. If you're planning on getting married, you ought to go ahead and do it. And so I called up my wife-to-be and said, honey, we're leaving. We're going to go on a tour. Don't know where, don't know when, but it's coming pretty quick. And I don't want to get a Dear John letter. I don't want to leave and then get a letter that says, Dear Wiley, I'm sorry, but I found somebody else. Because I had found her, and she had found me, and I didn't want that to stop. So I said to her, let's go on a date when I get back. And I went on a date with her and her parents, by the way. That was in the olden days, and Mr. and Mrs. Stevens were not too excited about their daughter dating a sailor anyway. And so we went on a date. And on that date, we went to a place called Knott's Berry Farm. And at Knott's Berry Farm, we walked around, and my wife's mother and father said they were going to go get a cup of coffee, and they would let us be by ourselves. And so we were walking around by ourselves. And there at Knott's Berry Farm that night, I asked her to marry me, and she said yes. And then I had to go back to San Francisco, and she was going on vacation with her parents to Denver, Colorado, where her grandfather and grandmother lived. And so we said our goodbyes, and she went to Denver, and I went to San Diego. And while in San Diego, the captain came back on board and said, fellas, we've had the timetable, the schedule, turned up. And we're leaving pretty quick. Not at liberty to tell you when, but I know it's going to be short. Only a few weeks and we're going to be out of here. Maybe even just a week. And so that night, I called my dear wife. And I said, dear wife, we're going to be going on another tour. And so anyway, at that point, I said, I know I've already asked you. I know I proposed to you at Knott's Berry Farm. And she said, yeah, and we need to get together and plan our wedding, when we're going to get married and so forth. And I said, well, baby, we don't have time. I'm going to be leaving shortly. She was still in Colorado with her mom and dad and grandparents. And we talked on the phone, and then she called me back again and said, mom and dad said if we want to go ahead and get married, that's okay with them. And my grandmother is a seamstress, she said, and she'll make me a wedding dress. And so they started working on a wedding dress, and we started getting ready to get married. And Grandma and Grandpa and Mom and Dad and my wife's sister and their dog Smitty all got in the car. Big old Oldsmobile. But they all got in the car, and they headed back to the San Fernando Valley. And I got out on the highway and stuck my thumb out and hitchhiked to the San Fernando Valley. And on September the 9th, in the year of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, 1962, we were married. A few days later, after we were married, we were on the beach, not too far from here, in a place called Laguna Beach. And we got up one morning, and I told my wife, honey, I'm going down to the beach. Come on down. And she said, well, I got to do my hair. And I said, okay, I'll meet you at the beach. And I went down to the beach, and while I was down at the beach, I was approached by two shore patrolmen. For those of you who weren't in the military, that's military police. They came up to me and said, are you Wiley Drake? And I said, yes. And they said, turn around. You're under arrest. And I said, what? They said, you're under arrest. You're AWOL. You're AWOL. I said, no, I'm not. I have leave, and I'm just got married. They said, well, we don't care. Your leave has been canceled, and you've got to be back at the ship. We're leaving, and you're AWOL, and we're going to put you in a paddy wagon and haul you back to San Diego. And while they were talking to me, my wife came out on the beach and said, Wani, what's happening? What's going on? And I said, well, I'm under arrest. I'm AWOL. Well, how did you mess that up? I said, baby, I didn't do it. The Navy did it. And so one of the guys said, look, first class, this guy's on his honeymoon. He just got married a few days ago. Let's cut him some slack. Let's figure out something to do. So they went over. They had to go to a payphone. They didn't have radios and cell phones and those things those days. They went over to a payphone and made a call to San Diego and came back over and said, okay, we talked to the chief in San Diego, and the ship's not leaving for a couple of days, but tomorrow by noon, you've got to be in San Diego. So you've got today and tonight, and we're going to give you a voucher for a bus, and you're going to take the bus to San Diego and go to the ship. Otherwise, we're going to put you in jail. So I said, okay. And my wife and I had our last night on our honeymoon. We'd only been married 3 days. Had our last night on the honeymoon. Spent the night in a hotel. Got up the next morning and had breakfast. I called her father and said, I'm being taken back to San Diego and your daughter's going to be stranded here in Laguna. And he said, well, remember I loaned you. He had loaned us his car, and so we had his car. And I was worried about my wife driving all the way back to the San Fernando Valley. That was a long way for me. And her dad said, oh, no, I trust her. She's a good driver. She has her driver's license, and she's driven that car before. So you go back to San Diego and get out of trouble, and she'll come home. So we said our goodbyes that day there on the beach in Laguna Beach. Went down to the parking lot and got in the car, and Barbara drove me over to Anaheim, where I got on the Greyhound bus and went to San Diego, back to the Kitty Hawk. And from there, we set sail. We got a few miles off the coast, and the captain came on and said, gentlemen, now you'll notice he didn't say ladies and gentlemen. We didn't have any ladies in the Navy in those days. It was just us boys. So he said, men, I am now at liberty to tell you that the President of the United States, John F. Kennedy, is going to be coming on our ship to inspect us, and then we're going to Vietnam. I had no idea where Vietnam was. One of my friends who was an old sailor, been in a long time, said, oh, that's where the war is at. It's not declared yet, but that's where we're at war. We're going to war, fellas. I couldn't call and tell my wife. I could just tell her I was aboard the Kitty Hawk. And anytime I sent her a letter, they would black out anything I told them that told her that they didn't want her to know. And so we went to Vietnam, and I spent several months in Vietnam aboard the USS Kitty Hawk. And finally, we finished our tour duty. We had several pilots shot down, and we finished our tour duty, and the Ranger and some other ships relieved us, and we headed back to the States. And so we came back to San Diego, and there was my dear wife, met us at the ship. And I had a little time off, and my wife and I, of course, did what every young couple do. They went to bed. And we had fun for the next few days. And then finally I had to say, baby, I got to leave. This has been great. I've had fun. But I got to go. So I went back aboard the Kitty Hawk, and we set sail again for Vietnam. Got letters from her, and after several months, I got a letter from her saying, that's what, baby, we're pregnant. Well, that vacation, that leave, caused us to produce a child that was born June the 14th, 1964, 2 years after we were married. And I kept getting letters, and she said, the baby's due, the baby's due. And I kept trying to ask the captain to let me go home early, and he said, no way. We're not going home until we get our job done. And you can't go because you've got a job to do. And so we finally got to come home. But it was in July of 1964, and my daughter had been born June the 14th, 1962. And so, when I got home, I had a new baby girl. And that was the beginning of our life together as man and wife, really, and mom and dad. And then in 1966, her sister came along. That was Carla. And then, during those years, it was being advised to people that they not have but two children. And I was just a dumb kid, didn't have enough sense to know that what they were doing was wrong. Had no idea what was going on. But in those days, you trusted your doctor and your preacher, your elders. And so my wife and I began to pray about. Now, by the way, I left out one part. While I was in Vietnam, I came to know Jesus as my Lord and Savior there aboard the Kitty Hawk. Many of you have heard that testimony. But at any rate, I was a Christian now and had two children. And after our second daughter was born, we went in for a doctor's appointment. My wife was healthy, but the doctor said, you need to come in for a checkup. You've had your baby, your second baby, and you probably ought to have a checkup. And so we went to the doctor, and I said, doctor, is there something wrong? Oh, no, he said, she's fine. But I just wanted to give her a checkup, make sure everything's okay. And so he did and came out and said, I got good news for you. Everything's okay. Baby's doing fine. You're fine. Your other little girl's doing fine. But he said, I want to talk to you, young couple. I want to tell you that you probably should not have any more children right now. And I said, well, why? Didn't make any sense to me then, doesn't make any sense to me now. He said, well, you know, your wife is young and she can have more children, but you know, she probably ought to wait a while before she has another child so she can develop a little bit more. After all, she's still just a little girl herself. And I knew about contraceptives, never had used one, but I knew about them. And the doctor said, you probably ought to use some kind of birth control, contraceptives. And I was just dumb as a rock. I thought the doctor knew what he was talking about, and so I wanted to be protective of my wife, and so I started using contraceptive device. Didn't like it. Went back to the doctor and said, doctor, I can't handle this. I like the real thing. I don't like something between me and my wife. And so he said, well, there's a new device out called an IUD, intrauterine device. And he said, it's nothing more. And he showed us one, a little coil of plastic. And he said, I can implant this inside your wife. And any time an egg comes down the fallopian tubes, that little coil will catch it and expel it. And she won't get pregnant. And you don't have to wear a prophylactic, a contraceptive. You can have sex normal, and everybody will be happy, and you won't have any more children for a while. And so I said, okay. Doctors, you know, you trust your doctor. And I thought that was a wise thing to do. And my wife and I both talked about it, and both of us agreed, yeah, we was going to do that. And so Barbara went in, and they put that little IUD in. And every time she would ovulate and produce an egg, she would have a little spot of blood in her pants. And she asked the doctor about that. He said, oh, that's nothing to worry about. All that is the fertilized egg that was fertilized, and when the IUD kicked it out, that's what the blood is. That's that little IUD kicking that little spot of blood out, so you'll not get pregnant. And early on, I began to realize that that was wrong. But for the next 10 years, actually about 9 years, my wife and I prayed about it and fretted over it. And finally, the doctor sent us a note and said, you've had that IUD inside of you now for 8.5 years. You need to come in and let me check it. And so we went in to check it, and the doctor said, oh, it's fine. It hasn't moved. It's in the right spot. It's doing great. You're doing great. You haven't gotten pregnant. Everything is fine. And my wife and I sat there and looked at each other and said, no, it's not. And my wife spoke even before I did and said, doctor, is that spot of blood that I find in my panties, is that a baby? And the doctor said, oh, no, 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 that's just a fertilized egg. And I said, well, doc, what would happen if the egg didn't come out? And I was just dumb. I didn't know. I said, what would happen if that little egg slipped off of the IUD and stayed in there, didn't come out as a spot of blood? He said, well, your wife would be pregnant with a baby. And I said, well, then what you're telling me is that that little spot of blood, if it comes out, is a spot of blood. If it stays in there, it's a baby. And it was as if somebody threw a bucket of cold water over me and over my wife. Because we realized that for almost 10 years, we had been aborting our babies. Now, a lot of people said, no, that's not an abortion, but it was. And so that day in the doctor's office, I turned to my wife and I said, honey, she said, I know what we've been doing is wrong. And she turned to the doctor and said, do I need to make another appointment to take that IUD out? And the doctor said, well, no, but you don't want to take it out. You'll get pregnant. And my wife said, I'll trust God. Not that device, and not you, doctor. And so the doctor, wanting to be big macho, said to me, now, son, you need to do what's right here as the leader of this family. And I said, you're right. I'm going to do what my wife tells me. Baby, do you want that thing out? And she said, yes, I do. The doctor said, are you sure? And my wife said, as sure as I've ever been about anything. I don't want to kill any more babies. Oh, that's not killing a baby. My wife said, doctor, in all due respect, you're wrong. In all due respect, doctor, I want that thing out. And I want it out now. And the doctor said, well, we'll need to make an appointment. I said, doctor, you told my wife just earlier, she didn't need an appointment to have it taken out. And you told me all you've got to do is reach up in there and take it out. You just reach up in there with your fingers and pull it out. He said, well, yeah, that's right. It is that simple. And I said, well, doctor, you're the doctor. But if you do not take it out, when I get my wife home, I will take it out. And he said, no, that won't be necessary. Barbara, come here. Put her up on the table, reached in there and took that IUD out and threw it in the trash. We both confessed our sins to the Lord, asked Him to forgive us, and He forgave us. And we went on with our life. In fact, I was in the ministry. We were busy. We were working. And we were in seminary. In 1976, we were in seminary. And we came back to Southern California for vacation. We were in seminary, and we came home for vacation, and we had just left Fort Worth, Texas, coming here to California, and I was a typical man. I'd say, okay, baby, go potty, because I'm not stopping. I'm going to California. And so she went to the bathroom, and she came out, and we got in our vehicle and headed to California with our two babies to come see Grandma and Grandpa. And we didn't get 20 miles down the road, and my wife said, baby, I need you to stop. I said, what? We haven't gotten anywhere yet. Not time to stop now. Baby, I need to stop. Please pull over somewhere and stop. And I said, I'll crawl up in the camper. We had a cab over camper. I said, crawl up in the camper and use the toilet. Use the porta potty. She said, no, honey, I really feel I need to go to the bathroom. So I said, okay. I pulled in the bathroom, took the girls to the potty. A few minutes, my wife came out. And she said, honey, I don't feel very good. And I said, well, I'm sorry. You got the flu or something? She said, no, I'm pregnant. I said, what do you mean you're pregnant? She said, yeah, I'm pregnant. I said, what do you mean? How can you be pregnant? She said, well, baby, we have had sex. And I said, yeah, but you don't look pregnant. Well, she said, I'm not very pregnant, but I am pregnant. I said, well, you just got an upset stomach. Because she said, I threw up in the bathroom. She said, that's how I know that I'm pregnant. And I said, baby, that don't mean you're pregnant. That just means you got an upset stomach. She said, honey, I've had two babies. I had morning sickness every morning of their 9 months inside of me. I know when I'm pregnant. I know the difference between being sick and having morning sickness. I'm having morning sickness, and I'm pregnant. And so I got excited and said, well, praise the Lord. We drove on back, made several stops because of her morning sickness, made several stops on our way back to California, came on back to California, and then in 1976, 10 years after our second daughter was born, our third daughter was born, and that's Jamie. And then a little over a year after that, Wiley Jr. was born. So you see, God had all intended for us to have other children. He intended, obviously, for us to have four. We cut it off at two. And God tried for 10 years to get Barbara pregnant, but we had the IUD in there, and we killed a whole bunch of babies. God has forgiven us for that, and He don't even remember it anymore. Because the beauty of forgiveness is, when I commit a sin, I can remember it. But God says He doesn't remember it anymore. So, 1964, Kim was born. 1966, Carla was born. 1976, Jamie was born. 1978, Wiley S. Drake Jr. was born. And that's our family. And that's my story. That's some of the history of the Drake family. The reason I do what I do is because God told me to. Not everything I've ever done has been right, and not everything I've ever done has been told to me by God, but most of what I've done has been what I call a God thing. And God's blessed it and used it. And I said the other day, I don't know if this Hawaii thing is a Wiley thing or a God thing, but I'm going to find out, because I'm going to do everything I can to encourage the people of the island of Hawaii to allow this preacher and this television program and this radio program to help them birth not babies, but babies in Christ. I don't know if they want to do that or not. They may see me as an intrusion. They may see my reputation as a troublemaker and other things as too intrusive for the beautiful Hawaiian island of Hawaii. But as God is my witness, I'm going to do everything I can to allow what I believe was a vision of God that my wife had. And that was one day to have ministry on the big island of Hawaii. She encouraged me, and we agreed under my leadership and her being subordinate to me as leader. We agreed to purchase a piece of property on the big island of Hawaii from an organization called Analoa, which is down in the Puna district over near Hilo. It's about 12 miles from Hilo. And some people will tell you one of the most beautiful parts of the island. Not the most exciting, like lava flows and that kind of thing, but one of the most beautiful parts that at one time was a lava flow. That whole part of the island is nothing but lava. And that property is there, and I still own it, and I'm going to use it to honor God. And one of the ways that I'm going to try to use it, if God will allow me, is that in January the 7th, through the 11th, that second week in January, after New Year's, after we've celebrated New Year's, I, with the Lord's help and the Lord's permission, I'm going to take Jaime Chan, my cameraman and producer, and Wiley Drake, the host of this show, and we're going to take the Wiley Drake Show on Crusade Radio and on Ustream.tv. And we're going to take it over there, and we're going to broadcast somewhere, I don't know where, but somewhere on the island of Hawaii. Twice a day, we're going to broadcast. Now, the time zone is different. It's 3 hours different. So our show will be on over there at 6 o'clock in the morning and at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And I'm inviting right now any Christian on the big island of Hawaii to come and be on the program with us. Any pastor, any director of missions, any district leader, any layman, any deacon, any Christian, any Judeo-Christian leader to come on those programs. We'll do two every day for 5 days. That's a total of 10 shows. Plus, we'll do one live from there that will be broadcast in New York. So we'll actually do 11 shows live from Hawaii. And I'm inviting right now, there's some 20 Southern Baptist churches on the island. And I don't know how many other independent Baptist and Pentecostal and Assembly of God and other evangelical churches. I don't know how many more are on the Big Island, but we're going to be in Hawaii for a week. And our theme for that week is going to be a big God doing big things on the big island. And I hope that if you're a Judeo-Christian person, you will meet up with us. I don't have any idea where we're going to be yet. As soon as we establish a headquarters, as soon as we establish a studio, if we can, we will. If not, we'll do a studio on the beach. We'll have a studio out on the property. I talked to a young fellow today about clearing a section of that property for me. Get the weeds off at least and some bushes. And I'm going to find out more about that. But we will be broadcasting live from Hawaii, the Big Island. There's Kona and Hilo and some other very famous names that I can't remember or pronounce. But we're going to be there. The Mauna Loa Macadamia Nut Company is there. And I'm going to make a trip to the Mauna Loa Macadamia Nut Company. And I'm going to buy me some Mauna Loa macadamia nuts to bring home with me from the island of Hawaii. I'm going to go and see where they grow them and where they package them and so forth. But anyway, that's a little bit of the word called history. H-I-S-T-O-R-Y. The word means his story. The title of today's show, if you want to come back and listen to it, will be called History of Wiley. History of Wiley. Now, you knew I was going to have to put my name in there. So just get over it. Because what I've talked about tonight includes the history of Arkansas, California, Vietnam, a lot of other places, my kids, my friends, all of those, but it's Wiley History is the title of the show tonight. We have about 7 or 8 minutes before we go off of Crusade Radio, and I would encourage you to call us. If you'd like to call and ask a question about tonight's show, about some of the history of Wiley Drake, you're welcome to do so. I would also encourage you that tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock Pacific Coast time, we will be going live in New York. And then at 9 o'clock, we'll go live again here on Ustream.tv. Remember, on Wednesdays, we do two shows. We do an 8 o'clock show and a 9 o'clock show. Huh? At 7, that's when your part comes on. Yeah, I'm sorry. At 7 o'clock, Jaime's part comes on, and then at 8 o'clock is when I come on. And then, of course, at 9. So listen in tomorrow. Start early, 7 o'clock California time. That is what I call Jaime Chan's inspirational, instructional videos. The runner-up to the Wiley Drake Show, the opening act, if you will, of the Wiley Drake Show. And it is all videoed and taped and put there normally at 8 a.m. to 9, and then I come on at 9. But on Wednesday, it's put up at 7, so that means Jaime's got to get up early tomorrow. Goes up at 7, and then I go on at 8. Now, we only have about 5 minutes left, ladies and gentlemen. If you'd like to call us on 559-592-5961, or you can reach us on 800-839-3002. Call us on either of those numbers, and we'll be glad to have you on the Wiley Drake Show. If no one else calls at 8 minutes past the hour, we will call this show to an end because Doug Millar does another show, and that show is at the top of the hour, 6 o'clock. So I try to make sure I go off at 2 minutes till, because I want to give him time to get on the line and get in the studio and get his show kicked off. And so I'll go out of here at 8 minutes after, 58 minutes after the hour. In the meantime, let me give you some basic information. The central headquarters of Wiley Drake Show and all that we do is the First Southern Baptist Church of Buena Park. Now, if you're watching, you can see that on the screen. But the website is firstsouthernbaptistchurchofbuenapark.com. That's the headquarters for all that we do. And now there's another organization that has an office here, and that office is the Office of the Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C. And that website is equally as long, but it's the Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C. No "the" in front, just Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C. And you can find that website. Now, on that website, and both of those websites, we also have an organization and a thing that we call telephonic prayer meeting. Telephonic prayer meeting. That means every day at 5 o'clock in the morning, California time, we go on a telephonic prayer meeting line, and we take your prayer calls, and we pray with you and pray for you. Now, if you want to send us a prayer request and you can't call in, you can send it to telephonicprayer@hotmail.com. telephonicprayer@hotmail.com. Now, if you want to join us on that telephonic prayer line, it's at 5 o'clock every morning, California time. That's 8 o'clock in Washington. It's for 2 hours. If you would like to join us, the phone number there is 712-432-1690. And you put in your access code 399-430-pound, and you can join us. Now, everything we do here is what I call talking about the ministry. About this ministry, we are a church, we are a church, we are a church. Those are the three things I say about this ministry. We only have about 1 minute before we go off of Crusade Radio. But I want you to know, folks, if you want to help us pay the light bill, you want to help us get to Hawaii, you want to help us get the word out, you want to help us in any way, you just make a donation to the First Southern Baptist Church of Buena Park. First Southern Baptist Church of Buena Park. The mailing address is 6801 Western Avenue. 6801 Western Avenue in the city of Buena, B-U-E-N-A, Buena Park, California. Now, if you want to send that, do that. If you want to call me, you can reach me on 714-865-8132, or you can email me at WileyWiley@att.net. WileyWiley@att.net. Ladies and gentlemen, it's 58 minutes past the hour on Crusade Radio. I want to say, remember, do justice, love mercy, and walk with Almighty God. Good night, and God bless you. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we have now 2 minutes left in our broadcast. I want you to know I appreciate your prayers. I want you to keep praying for our nation. And as I've said before, I want to close out tonight with a political statement. My political statement is simply this: whoever wins tomorrow morning, God is not going to be surprised. God's not going to get up and say, "Oh my goodness, I can't believe he won." God knows who's going to win. And whoever wins, I'm not going to like if either one of them wins. I can tell you that right now. But whoever wins, I promise you, I will pray for them. I've been praying for B. Hussein Obama for 4 years. Some of it was imprecatory. Most of it was not. But I will pray for the new president. and I will let him know, we will hold him accountable. And we will pray for him every day. And I'll let him know that as soon as he's sworn in, that we're going to be praying for him every day. We're already praying for him every day. And we'll increase our prayers for the new president of the United States. Let me remind you that the theme for this program is what we're going to close out with on these last few seconds. And that is, do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with Almighty God.
I sit and wait. There's an angel contemplate my fate. Do they know the places where we go when we're gray and old? 'Cause I have been told that salvation lets their wings unfold. So when I'm lying in my bed, thoughts running through my head, and I feel that love is dead, I'm loving angels instead. And through it, oh, she offers me protection.